I'm going to be leading our discussion this morning about speculative fiction and sex. We're going to talk about all kinds of aspects of this, about gender decisions, about sexuality, about whether or not to include that aspect that affects pretty much everyone's lives, including fictional characters in character creation. And so I'm going to introduce our panelists and then ask them a few questions, and then we'll take some questions from the floor. If you have a question, please go to the microphone, and please make sure that it's an inclusive question. Do not just ask Jeannie Minutia about one of her alternate universes, because it's not fair to the rest of the panelists. Just a reminder, because it's early, and this is a reminder to my panelists as well, if you have devices with you that make noises, please make them not make noises. All right, so now we know why Wes wants to be introduced last, so he doesn't get busted. All right, so starting at the far end of the panel from me, we have Nick Cole. Nick is an Army veteran and working actor living in Southern California. When he is not auditioning for commercials, going out for sitcoms, or being shot, kicked, stabbed, or beaten by film That's school happened. Students, the author of The Old Man in the Wasteland and The Wasteland Saga can often be found as a guard for King Philip II of Spain or a similar role in the opera Don Carlo at Los Angeles Opera. And his most recent work is Soda Pop Soldier, and the next book will be Control Alt Revolt, which will be on sale in October. Welcome, Nick.
Thank you. Nice to meet everybody.
And our next author is Marisa Acachello Marchetto.
Well done.
And Marisa is a cartoonist for The New Yorker. Her work has appeared in The New York Times, Glamour, and O, the Oprah magazine, among other publications. She's also the author of the graphic memoir, Cancer Vixen, named one of Time's top 10 graphic memoirs, and a finalist for the National Cartoonist Society Graphic Novel of the Year. She's the founder and chair of the Marisa Acachello Marchetto Foundation at Mount Sinai Beth Israel Comprehensive Cancer Center and lives in New York. Her most recent book is Antenna, which has traveled to us from the future because it's actually a September release, but her publisher has kindly made it available for you here at Comic-Con. So welcome, Marisa. And Camilla DiArecco. Camilla's client list includes Dark Horse Comics, Image Comics, Tokyo Pop, Hasbro, Disney, Sanrio, and Neil Gaiman. Her own characters and properties, Tampopo and the Helmet Girls, are international sensations, and her emotive paintings have propelled her to the top rank of the new contemporary art movement. In 2011, she was nominated for the Joe Shuster Award and the Will Eisner Award, two most prestigious awards in comics. She lives in Vancouver, British Columbia. Welcome, Camilla. And Jeannie Koch. Jeannie Koch is a writer by night and a career marketing professional and social media expert by day with more than 25 years in sales, advertising, and marketing. She lives with her husband, daughter, and the pets that own them all. She's pretty sure none of them are actually aliens. And Jeannie's most recent work is Alien Separation. Kat, don't make me kick you out. Welcome, Jeannie. And the person who foolishly sat in the Where I Can Reach Him chair, Wesley Chu. Alex Award-winning novelist Wesley Chu was born in Taiwan. He's a member of the Screen Actors Guild, a Kung Fu master, a former stuntman, and the former vice president of large financial institutions. He lives in Chicago and is a two-time Campbell Award nominee. He can be found online at chewforthought.com, and his most recent book is Time Salvager. Welcome, Wesley. So So when we were putting this panel together, one of the things that came up was the idea that sex in speculative fiction isn't often talked about in a general sense. We talk about sex in cross-genre fiction a lot. We talk about it in paranormal romantic fiction, or we talk about it in science fiction romance. And we sometimes only talk about it as it's associated with romantic relationships. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but it's a critical element in every work, whether or not it's being addressed overtly, and even that decision to address it overtly or not is a decision. So we're actually going to start with Wes, because I think his opening chapter in Time Salvager is actually a sterling example of the way that sex can illustrate a character and their motivations, because sex can be a lot about a lot of things. It can be about romance, it can be about power, it can be about any variety of things. So the first question is, how do you include sex or sexuality in your character creation, and what are some of the reasons for doing it? And you get to go first.
I always felt that in speculative fiction, in the past, we've always been a little bit of a prude when it comes to how we portray sex. What Mary Elizabeth said in Time Salvager, there is a elderly 80, 90-year-old woman who basically runs a technology isolationist empire, and she's a sex fiend. And her thing is she has beautiful male clones that she has sex with, because that's kind of what they do. And for her, part of it, she enjoys sex, part of it is because she enjoys the power of it. In the past, for fantasy, we've seen this on Game of Thrones, we see this on, you know, how they portray Dragonlance and how they do romance in the olden times. It's either a very male-driven power trip, or it's like, this is romance. These are the two that was meant to have, and if they're gonna have sex, it's because they were meant for each other. And right now, these days, we see a lot more variations of what sex is, how more casual it can be, and we see it flipped around where, you know, women have more control over what, you know, over their story, their agenda with how sex should work. I mean, Cameron Hurley had a very interesting series called Mirror Empire, where she basically flipped around the entire narrative of sex, where it is more about the women being in control, the women having the ability to, you know, dictate their own, what sex is on their own terms.
Me? I just like having sex, and so do my characters. So.
All right, that works.
Sexuality is a part of us, as is romance, as is humor, as is everything else. And so when I'm creating any characters, I want them to be fully formed, fully dimensional. And that means they have a sexual life, whether they are gay, straight, bi, uninterested in sex, whatever, they still have that, and that's part of their character and part of who they are. So to me, writing that, and I realized very early on that there's just not a lot of what I'm necessarily doing in what I'd call straight science fiction, but I didn't care because I didn't want to write characters who, you know, you blew back the curtain, maybe you thought maybe they had a sexual relationship. Plus, I think you learn a lot about characters and about relationships by seeing their intimacy and how they act and how they treat each other when they're in bed. So, plus, like I said, they enjoy it, and so do I.
For my part, I use, my character is, she's not even 15 yet, so she's 14, so she doesn't understand sex or anything like that. So, but as the character is going to mature, she's gonna learn about that with this other more experienced character, and it's going to be a really, I don't want it to be this like Twilight idea where it's just like, it's so perfect and sparkly, literally. but I do want it to be really realistic. I think that sex can be portrayed as a very, you know, it has to be that perfect moment, or there's like music in the background, and if it's not, then it's not, you know, you're not doing it right. And then I also have this other story I'm working on, and it is The Bride of Frankenstein, a space horror. And the bride is dominated sexually by the doctor. Mm-hmm. And so that's going to be really different for me because I've never drawn that. And but then she'll also experience sex in a liberating way when she meets, you know, another character. And so that's going to be really interesting to portray sex in those two different ways. And then as far as my paintings go, I don't have like a representation of it, but I'm criticized often for painting nudes, and I find that it's really, whenever there's a nude involved, people want to they want to tie that in with sex and that it's a sexual thing, but it's not. For me, with my Italian background, nudity is just that. It's just, we're all naked. We all have nipples, you know.
Yeah.
But as soon as you paint a nipple, it's like, oh my God. Yeah. It's sex, and I'm like, you've got them too. Like, everyone has them, and just relax. It's just a boob.
Dirty girl.
It is, right? Yeah.
Dirty
and,
girl.
So this one particular art show I did, I actually didn't paint any breasts, but they were all naked. What I did was I painted them flat, and people still said, oh, that's sex. I'm like, they literally have no anatomy. So then after that, I decided, you know what? This is how I'm going to treat people who don't understand that nudity is just that. I painted this, it was about this big, and it was two giant breasts, lactating rainbows in a sea of color, and I called it nips. And it was a very popular piece. So that's how, you know. that's how I deal with sex in my work.
I think, first of all, sex, science fiction and sex, aren't they the same thing? I mean, really, what's the difference? I have this antenna. The story is about how she's human and through her own bad behavior dies and meets her higher self, whose name is Super Ann. And Super Ann is a spirit. She's like her higher self, and Anne is human, and the two of them really don't get along, even though they're identical cosmic doppelgangers. And Anne has this boyfriend who's kind of a cad, and Super Anne is lusting after this brainiac brain surgeon. And the way I treated sex in my book is Anne passes out, and Super Anne, through her body, jacks her and has sex with the guy that she likes. So it's kind of like I wanted to create more of like a romance story and sort of treat science fiction as just part of the story and use the whole sex thing as like an exploration of connecting with your higher self and the power of sex and what it does to the universe and how the two of them bond. But also it's kind of an act of betrayal. So yeah. I dealt with, you know, how do you feel? I mean, what it's like, and just putting those good vibes out in the universe, but it's also a romantic story and a betrayal.
That sounds amazing.
I kind of like your rainbow boobs. I kind of want that, actually.
We could show the rainbow boobs.
We could pull it up, yeah. I can't.
The actor in me right now and the writer says we need a contrarian, so I'll be your Huckleberry. Sex ruins everything. It's a lot of fun. I mean, I'm pretty sure most of us have been part of sex in this room, or, you know, it is Comic-Con, hoping to be. But here's the truth. Science fiction is fantastic. It's wonderful. It's exciting. Those are all things that people say about sex and that are true about sex. And what we all learn about when we're 12 or 13 or 14, we're having all these, like, in my life, we were all playing Dungeons and Dragons, and it was a lot of fun. And then one day you discover girls, and girls are even more exciting than ninth level paladins killing, you know, ancient huge red dragons. And you begin to lose the desire to go slay that dragon and get that hoard, and you become obsessed with what? Conquering the girls. So there's a lot of valid points there. But what I'm finding in science fiction these days is, and a lot of writing on television and things like that, is there is an agenda of sex, and sometimes it comes in too much, or it comes in over not even-handed. And the danger with putting sex in anything is it distracts from the wonder of the story.
Only
now,
if
we
wrong.
If we go, yeah, and I totally could be wrong, but is Han Solo, in the moment that he's navigating the asteroid field, is he thinking about nailing Princess Leia? No, he's thinking about not getting killed. But the problem when you start going down the sex path is it becomes very important because it is important. And the danger is if it's not balanced, it's not handled well, it can take over the story. And it has taken over many stories. So just to provide the contrary point of view, that's what I would say.
I mean, if Han Solo is thinking about sex while he's trying to escape the asteroid, he's got some problems.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
He needs to see a counselor or something.
Yeah. But I mean, but he's allowed, after the moment he's through that, he can think, she thinks I'm pretty awesome right now.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, he's doing it to have sex later.
Yeah. You know, well, he wants to survive to have sex with somebody later.
Yeah,
not necessarily Leia, just somebody. I'm going to survive this. But
well, but is the danger of...
There's lots of women on lots of planets.
The danger is that now becomes a major part of the storyline. You only have, well, if it's Star Wars, you've only got 120 minutes. Do you stop the adventure and the action and the lightsabers and the warp drive to woo and pitch woo and court
and romance? Yeah, actually you do, because you know what? 2 hours straight of action, or one book where there's all action and there's no breathing time, becomes repetitive. It's too much to take. You want that downtime. You want those moments. If you think of Indiana Jones and the Raiders of the Lost Ark, the first movie, you get those little downtimes with Marion, and they make the movie better. Their romance, it's moving things along, it's moving their relationship along, but it also gives you the breathing space for the action. 2 hours of action is exhausting.
I feel like you can get a lot of character development when you have two characters fall in love, especially if you transition the one character from somebody who's never opened up their heart and who's just given up, and then he finds that person, or she finds that person that brings them back to life, that has given them hope again. And I like seeing that. I don't like when they shoehorn romance in, or when they use a woman just for the romance. That drives me crazy. Because
we're women.
We're more than just sex, you know?
Yes.
And so I don't want to see a female character just put into the movie just to give the male lead, you know, some action.
Well, I mean, but you know what? I would like to see some men interjected into the story and use this.
Yeah.
You know, something to give a woman action.
Joanna Russ.
Like that, I kind of like seeing.
Go back and read Joanna Russ.
What's that?
Go back and read Joanna Russ.
Rejoin the what?
Joanna Russ had some stories where it was very much males as sex objects. So one of the opportunities that science fiction offers us, which some of you have touched on, is it gives you a lot of different ways to explore this. It gives you some options, whether it's clones, whether it's alternate universes, or whether it's access to another power, but that also gives you some other ways to explore ideas. So Marisa and Jeannie have both had scenes where they've had characters who have had interactions with another form of themselves interacting with their partner. Wesley mentioned that you know, he's got the opportunity with the clones and all that. So how do you take advantage of the opportunities that science fiction offers to do something, a different expression that still speaks to our common experiences with sex?
Well, I think sex is so powerful. I mean, the moment when you engage with somebody and you are blending energies, and that explosion when you actually orgasm, I mean, that should not be minimized for anybody. And I think to use that potent thing, I mean, that's like a really powerful thing, and I just think I think it's really a cool thing. Mm-hmm. have that, to me, to have that like energetic exchange, and like what I did with Antenna, I just exploded that into the universe and made that a very powerful expression. And I do think the more love you put out there, the more love is in the universe and the better off we all are. So to me, it was coming from love.
Yeah. I also think that you, my series is female driven, it's first person POV, we're seeing it from Kitty's perspective. And I think that, I mean, she is very much, a lot of her enemies will call her a feminist throwback, okay? And she firmly believes that it's her body, she gets to do what she wants with it. And I was kind of shocked. The first real sex scene in this book is literally the midpoint of the book, of In Touched by an Alien, which is the first in the series. And I couldn't believe how many people said, wow, she's really a slut. I love the book, but she's such a slut. She slept with him after the first day. And that's 50,000 words of action, and they've almost died 6 or 7 times in those 50,000 words. I think it's perfectly okay to say, hey, you know, even the Terminator has romance and sex in it. Yeah. That drives that story. Mm-hmm. Okay, so acting like sex is not a place in that, it all depends on how you do it. But also from a gender standpoint, not just sex, but the gender roles, I think having female characters who do get to decide when they're having sex and who they want to have it with, and not necessarily pounding through and saying, you, I choose you, and you will come with me.
Pounding
through. But, you know, you're mine, go. Mm-hmm. But actually making a determination, I like that, I can tap that, whether I'm marrying that or not. This can just be a one-night stand, this could be a fling, I don't know, I don't care. I think that gives your female characters a lot more power.
I mean, I agree with Jeannie. I think we put, especially in this country, mm-hmm. we put sex on a pedestal, and we equate it to romance. You know, romance is powerful, love mm-hmm. is powerful, but sex is not romance,
yes.
Okay? And in many cultures, sex is pretty casual. You know, it's something that, you know, you like somebody well enough to get a little naked with them, and it's all good in that. But let's not make it some kind of like a special mind meld thing going where, mm-hmm. you know, because it's they're different things. Love, romance, and sex are different things, and we should treat it as such. You know,
and like Jeannie
says,
blend.
Sometimes, many times they blend. Yeah. But you know, sometimes you know after. You almost get killed for half a dozen times, and you go through hell together. That's a nice way to just kind of say, you know, let's cap it off, cap off the evening.
We survived. Yeah.
Just in case this is our last time.
Yeah, just last time. Let's do it. Yeah.
Of course, it's also nice if you actually have other people around to have sex with, which, you know, Nick doesn't always provide for.
Well, my books always provide for that.
What?
But, you know, in this panel already on that question, there were people that said, okay, sex is a sacred experience. And then on the other side of the panel, there was someone who was saying, well, it's a casual experience and it's kind of like a sport or a melatonin or a cocktail, you know, just something you can knock out. So the danger is you're profaning the sacred for somebody, you know. If someone treats sex as a pedestal thing, and we don't know our readers, and you go in and you say, oh, no, it's a casual knockoff, you know, you're making a bold statement to somebody that might not agree with you.
You can't please all the people all the time, and you shouldn't even try.
I agree, but, I mean, it's different for whatever character you're writing. Yeah, and right. You know what? For some people, maybe it is an expression of love. I mean, with my character, it was an expression of love for Super Ann, but for Antenna, it was like betrayal and a body jacking. So,
yeah, it's different. I just do not think you can write anything good if what you're trying to do is please everybody. It is impossible to do mm-hmm. that. Yeah. And I think your writing, your movie, your play will suffer dramatically if what you're trying to do is be as all things to all people. Mm-hmm. It's impossible. The number one show, whatever it is right now, I will guarantee you that in the general population, most of that population isn't watching it, and it's still number one. You don't need everybody. You just need the people who get what you're writing and mm-hmm. enjoy what you're writing.
Yeah.
Everybody doesn't have to.
Mm-hmm. And you're writing fiction, too, so you're trying to take people out of the real world and mm-hmm. present them with something that maybe they don't have or they can't have. So you give them something to step out of reality. So for me, like, I wouldn't create a character that, you know, if that character is driven, is a Libra, let's say, and is all about the romance, then I wouldn't have them have, like, a bad sexual experience and be like, oh, I don't want to have sex again. You know, you want to give them the fantasy that maybe reality denies them. So for me, I always want my characters to be, like, for love and sex to be a very beautiful thing, but I also don't. I mean, it's messy too. So you don't. I've drawn that before, where there's this character who's really in love with this one man, but he used her for sex, and he was just a bad man. But their sex was hot, and his, you want to show that. I don't want to show bad sex.
There's nothing wrong with showing bad sex.
Bad sex is most sex. By the way.
I actually like drawing.
Sorry.
I mean, how many people on this panel love drawing sex? I mean, to me, that's really fun. What? I think it's really fun.
I'm an author. I'm not an artist. You guys are the artists.
All right. Well, I love drawing sex.
Yeah, I do too.
I think it's really fun. Mm-hmm.
Well, and I very much like one of Camilla's pieces where her character has the snake for the hat.
And
it's sort of like, and you talked about the fact that it's a metaphor for you of the way that the brain is the most important mm-hmm. organ yeah. in terms of sex, and I tend to very much agree. And whether there's a visual element or not, when you're creating your fictional characters and you're presenting them to people, you also get to, you know, you're seeking ways to convey whether it's a positive sexual experience or not, and possibly even to convey, you know, some of that excitement and stuff. So what is something that you pull out of the toolbox to say, hey, this is sexy?
I wanted to show people that image you were referring to, which is this one, if you guys can see. It's a girl with a giant snake on her head. And the metaphor behind this one, which we were talking about, is that snakes are symbols of sex. And for me, in that particular image, I wanted to use the snake to represent her mind and how the mind is, to me, is the sexiest thing. And it is powerful, and she's in control because she's holding the snake. So in a lot of my work, I do use sex or the idea of power and the symbology differently for each character. It's really interesting because sometimes, I'll create a painting and I have it. For me, it's not sexual at all. This image is so tiny you probably couldn't see it, but it's a girl with a hole in her chest, and there's a rainbow spilling out of it. And I had a father come by today, and his daughter really loved the painting, but he's like, "Oh, that's not for you." And I'm like, "Well, why?" He's like, "It's too sexual." And there's nothing in my mind that is sexual about that at all. Whereas other times I'm being very forceful with it. You know, I did this one called The Playful Bunny, where she's naked and there's chocolate everywhere, which I was being very obvious, and that was a very popular image. But for me, it's, you know, when I put out an image, one singular image, and I can't tell you a story, I can't tell you what to think, it's all a subconscious reaction that people have to it. I can just hope for the best and, you know, hope that people see the metaphor, but I don't ever try to control it anymore. I mean, I did with Nips, but that was me just being, you know, funny.
We're very puritanical country still. Puritans left their mark on this country. I don't know, people get here from other countries and they're relaxed and free, and after a couple of years they're as puritanical as the rest of us. Mm-hmm.
Like, I mean, if we're more conservative than the Japanese, I mean, those are very Japanese people. They're very conservative people, but somehow they're like a boobs in commercials and they're all okay with that.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You know? Mm-hmm. We get a wardrobe malfunction and it's like, oh my God.
Yeah. People's careers are ruined because you saw their nipple.
My damn kids will never be the same again.
Yeah. I was in Italy, actually, and there was a magazine stand. I think it was like Vogue Italy, and it was a naked girl, and she was wearing a necklace. And it was the first, I was 14 at the time, so I didn't understand what I was looking at, because I've never seen that in North America. For me, it was always cover it up. Yeah. And I was like, is this a nudie magazine? Like, I didn't understand. And they're like, no, this is our fashion magazine. My aunts picked it up, and they didn't understand my idea or my concept of sex and nudity. Mm-hmm. So it's really different. It's very culturally, it's completely different here. And in Japan, I mean, it's all closed door, but do whatever you want, you know. Yeah. Well, like, yeah. Yeah. Actually, literally, even with octopuses, it's crazy.
Yeah, yeah, tentacles.
Tentacles.
Good old tentacles. Yeah. We're not going to tentacles that relax.
Yes, no tentacle porn discussions.
No.
Well,
no.
We already decided we wouldn't go there just yeah. to be nice because it's morning.
I'm seeing expressions of appreciation from the audience. Okay, so I'm going to open it up to questions from you guys. So if you'd be so kind, just go to the mic if you have a question.
First of all, love your cosplay. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Just as a general comment, you notice that a lot of science fiction, especially set in the future, still treats sexuality as we do today. Whereas if you look at our history, like just 100 years ago, a woman showing their thigh would be absolutely radical. Mm-hmm. So here's the problem. If you kind of just keep going with that trend, you want to write a future setting, and you want to display how society itself has changed sexually, but the character is so used to it that they don't comment on it. How would you kind of display that without it being the point of the story?
Some of that's going to be in description. Some of that's going to be in just you show, you know, people naked walking down the street, and maybe your character goes, oh, what an interesting, you know, what interesting piercings or whatever, so that they're commenting to somebody. There's always the, you know, the outsider. One of the nice things that my series is set in present day, so the mores are what we have right now. But because Kitty is a human and she's meeting all these aliens, you get to see that through her eyes and how they're the same and how they're different. So some of that's just craft and technique, but you can do it by showing that your character is not phased by, you know, we're all up here naked. Mm-hmm. And, you know, wow, she chose to wear a hat. You know, that's so radical. She put on any form of clothing, for example. Yeah. You know, that can be, you can do it something like that. And it just doesn't have to be a big scene. It can be a little scene. Mm.
Another way to do it is your focus. So let's say right now there's a beautiful naked woman sitting in that chair right there. Mm-hmm. And now, I'm looking, that's a really nice chair. You know, I mean, what are you focused at? I mean, if it's something that your narrator just can't stop looking at the woman because this is so radical and new, then you're pulling that woman and her nudity out of the ordinary. Mm-hmm. But if there's everything else is going on and he sees the woman and, you know, his gaze just passes right by her, then you're establishing that this is not a new or special thing. Mm-hmm.
I might say, you know, and I think that's, I write post-apocalyptic fiction, so sometimes that sex that I use, society is devolved, and so it's maybe a little more closer to what we came out of. But I would say that in the future kind of sex type stuff, sex is always so closely tied to commercialism. And commercialism is decided by a zeitgeist. Like, we want to sell soap or we want to sell video games. So let's figure out what's sexy. And so what I think you're always going to have in sort of science fiction or sex, you are going to have a specific group of people who objectify another group of people. And that's what they're going to use to sell soap. So the question is, where are we going? And in a certain way, and you know, I'll probably get in trouble, but I think we're beginning to again objectify a lot of women to the point of taking away from the feminist movement of the 70s, and we're turning a lot of women into sex objects by telling them this is the only way you're going to get attention is to wear this kind of clothing to do these things, and that's negative, and it's not always a positive thing. But I think in a certain way, we actually might be regressing, even though there's more being shown. Philosophically, we might be regressing.
I agree with you 100%. I mean, if you look at anchors on television, they're wearing less and less clothes, and they're showing more and more cleavage and more arms, and their hair is bigger and bigger and bigger. And if you look at Italian television, they're total bombshells as anchors, right?
Oh, God, yeah.
And they're like, you know, blah, 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 blah. And you're like, okay, you're supposed to be talking about the news, you're supposed to be telling us what the headlines are, and yet, like, you know what, there are people who probably want to fuck you right now. Yeah. And, like, yeah. Everything is so sexed up, and if everything is so sexed up, like, okay, I'm sorry, but then what's so sexy about sex?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, I think my husband, he plays a lot of video games. I'm sorry. And he...
Don't be sorry.
I love video games.
No. But there's this one platform that you can... Yeah, you can play video games and people can watch you, and you get followers and donations, and you make money. I don't remember what it's called.
Twitch.
But he was getting a little upset because he's a really good gamer, and he wasn't getting a lot of followers. And so he went and he's like, "Well, what can I do?" So he went up to the top five, mm-hmm. and it was all girls that couldn't play, but they had really low cut tank tops, and it was just jiggly. And he was like, "So." The fact that I can play a video game really well means nothing because this girl has really big boobs. And he got really disappointed in that it went that way. But, I mean, sex sells, and it's it sells everything. Even
it sells everything. Yeah.
It does.
I know.
But it's a choice. You have the choice to turn away, like your husband. You have the choice to say... Well, I mean, there's a lot of great women gamers who don't do that.
No, it's true. It's true. Absolutely. I told him he should just take his shirt off and, you know, give the ladies something to look at.
I'll say real quick.
You should paint his nipples like rainbow.
Kind of. Oh my God.
Every
that would be kind of funny. I would watch that.
I would watch that too.
Every science fiction person knows the best way to outdo the hot girl, and it's called the Jeff Goldblum maneuver. Be really funny, and you can beat any hot girl.
So well, wait a minute.
He's just going to become Jeff Goldblum.
Wait, did you just pull a Jeff Goldblum right there?
I might have.
I think so.
I mean, I think it's also changed definitely more recently in the past couple of years. I mean, you know, sex is no longer binary, first of all. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you look at a show like Sense8, which basically shows many spectrums of sex and love. And, you know, we're becoming more open to the concept of different things. So, yeah, it has been getting worse and maybe more conservative in the way it's been portrayed. But it's also, I think it might be also getting better at the same time. Mm-hmm. So there's definitely a lot more ways. I mean, what was that? There's a new game coming out. I think it was, Nintendo is showing, is allowing, like, you know, same-sex relationships now or something like that.
Mm-hmm. I think it's the new Harvest Moon.
Yeah,
I think it's a new Harvest Moon. You can choose to build a family with a person of the same game gender. So I think we kind of veered off what you asked originally, but hopefully you enjoyed the answers anyway. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my question is, how do you decide how to write your sex scenes, whether you're going to do a Playboy version or a Hustler version, you know?
Is that the only two choices?
I think it really depends on the character and where you want to take the story. Mm-hmm. If you want to do something super sexy or Playboy or you know, more interesting, it depends on the story that you want to tell and where you want to take that character.
It also depends on the words you use. Do we have anybody under 18 in the room? Can you raise your hand if you're under 18?
Marisa already said fuck.
I said fuck.
Oh, all right. No. Okay, so if you say come and spell it C-O-M-E or spell it your Playboy, if you spell it C-U-M, you're Hustler. If you say orgasm, you're not. So your word usage is very key, and you need to decide whether you will write, you know, the gentle, which is like, you know, a lingering glance, and at the end they get a chaste kiss after they're married, or do you want to go steamy hot, or do you want to go into erotica? And you need to make that determination, and some of your characters will tell you, but you need to decide that before you do it, because then it's all word usage. And I would just recommend when you say, okay, I think I do want to do this, I do want to do that, but if you want to go and write erotica, buy erotic fiction and see what they're using. Pick up several books that are, you know, on the shelves right now or on Amazon selling well right now and see what they're doing. I'm not Playboy or Hustler. I'm hot and steamy. I'm like the five, but I don't flip over into the erotic side. And it's all based on word usage. I use the word breasts and occasionally boobs, and that's it. Tits, I don't use tits, because tits starts flipping you. Okay, so, and it's actually, it's very, Harlequin has a lot of help for people who are writing sex and romance. Harlequin and RWA, Romance Writers of America. So, and I'm saying go there because those are the people that are writing this every day, day in, day out. So you get a lot of good advice from that.
Thank you.
I was wondering if you've ever had pushback from your editors or publishers to either include more sex or include or like remove a sex scene that you've had in a piece of work that you wanted to publish.
Only if it doesn't belong, you know? If it needs to be there. Sex can come on many. I actually don't write sex in my books, not because they don't have sex. It's because for me, the actual physical activity of sex isn't as important as the emotional reason. Mm-hmm. A good sex scene is like a good fight scene, So if you haven't, early in my career, I had a lot of fight scenes because I love fight scenes. And it's one of the things I had to learn to roll back is if you have a scene where it's just, all this chaos is happening and you're like, after a while, you get a little bored. So an editor will look at that and go, look, that three-page action scene or that three-page sex scene, could come down, nobody's that good, we could come down to 6 minutes or something.
My characters are. My characters are that good. They're better than that good, actually.
I'm just ratting myself out, aren't I? No.
Mine, on the other hand, they can go for hours.
So yeah, if an editor, I doubt they will say, unless it's like an erotica editor or a romance, I don't talk about that, but if an editor says this scene needs more sex or this scene needs less sex, it will be because of the story, not because they think, we're adding more steam to the book.
It's all a pacing issue. This is book 11 of this series, and I've only had one book, and it was book 2, Alien Tango, where my editor's and she didn't even ask me to remove stuff. Basically, she was saying your male character has been badly injured, and even though he's an alien and they have very fast regeneration, which is why they can go for hours, but they have very fast regeneration, he cannot possibly be in the mood right now, so I want you to change that. And then I had to add other scenes in. She wanted some more action here and something more explanation and narrative there. And I had another sex scene that I really liked, and I thought, I don't need it. I need the space. I wanna have more room to do all the other things she wants. So I'm just gonna cut this one. And I altered the other scene to make it more appropriate. And it actually works. Again, it tends to work better when you have a good editor and your editor is telling you, change this here. But she never says put a sex scene in. She never says take a sex scene out. It's normally change it a little bit here. This doesn't seem realistic for this but in terms of everything else, what my editor cares about is the overall storyline and the pacing. How is that going?
Well, in my book, Antenna, I actually used, there's another sex scene in it, and I use it as comedy.
Mm-hmm. Oh, nice. Yeah.
So, that was kind of a punchline. It was actually a breakup scene, but the way I treated it was it was kind of comical at the same time. And, there's an opportunity where it doesn't have to be about love, it doesn't have to be about sex, it could be about something funny. Mm-hmm. And that's another way of taking sex, too, and making it like a punchline, like a joke, and kind of like a heartbreaking joke, but it's kind of dark and funny.
Yeah. I've never had pushback from an editor, but I did have an interesting thing about fetishes, that a lot of my girls have things in their mouth. For me, it represents wanting to eat things. But my licensee in France said they won't publish anything that has a girl having something in her mouth because it's too sexual. Yeah. But they don't mind nudity.
Yeah. That is so weird.
Yeah. I know. It's the French.
We've got five. We've got 5 minutes, so we have time. Thank you. Okay. We have time for the last question.
Hi. You mentioned before bad sex and awkward sex, and I was wondering how do you as artists and writers explore the more awkward parts of sex, like the STD conversation or birth control use, or I totally had gonorrhea but it's totally clear now, and things like that. Or if that's even an issue, in science fiction.
Well, what I would say is we're not writing documentaries.
Right.
And that's not fun. I'll just be honest, that stuff's not fun. It's not real. The majority of science fiction that you're going to read, I think we're trying to entertain you because we're just We are prostitutes to an extent. We're trying to entertain you for money. So if you go see a prostitute today, she's going to keep it as fun and sexy, just like Playboy. Those girls don't look like that. It's made to entice you and titillate you. And so that's what we're often doing. And the editing question, that's what our editors are doing. We're trying to do things that keep it real and interesting for you. And I think that there is a time and a place where a writer might want to put in something that's truthful and it's functional. And that's probably where you're going to get some pushback when they say, you know, this kills the mood. This is not fun. And so I don't know that inside, you remember, this is fantasy. It's adventure. I don't know that it's always, you know, I, as a writer, I don't know that I want to do that. I can't speak for everybody else. I can speak for myself. I don't know that I want to. I don't know that I want to kill the vibe for you, unless I'm writing dystopian, and I want to show you that there's consequences. So.
But you know, again, it depends on the tone of your book. If you're writing, you know, a YA coming of age, and you're trying to be gritty and realistic, yeah, you work it in. I'm writing in this series. This is, you know, science fiction with a lot of action, humor, and romance in it. I don't talk about that because for exactly what Nick's saying. But in other things. Yeah, it just depends on the tone that you want to do. And again, it's in, you get, the great thing about adding in something like, oh my God, I need to take birth control, or oh my God, that was disgusting, is that you make it more real for your readers. It just depends on the level of realism that you're going for and the tone of your story.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and, other people yeah. who are not Jeannie, because we're running out of time.
Okay, I mean, real quick, I mean, every word and scene, every word or description in a scene should be about the character of the plot. So if you're, you know, talking about birth control or awkwardness of it, you are telling the reader something about the character or the situation that they're in. So keep that in mind. If you're going to bring that into the story, there has to be a purpose behind it besides just, you know, being real.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right.
Or not being real.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Did that answer it? Thank you. Thank you guys so much for joining us.